So let's just do a little catch up here. This video is part of the overhaul of this white Raleigh Caprice that you can see upside down in the workstand here. During the dismantling, I encountered what is probably the toughest cotter pin I've ever known. And this is in nearly half a century of tinkering with bikes. I run a bike recycling scheme where we went through literally thousands, that's not an exaggeration, of bikes. Probably half of which had cotter pins. I've never ever had a cotter pin which has defeated the car ball joint splitter tool, which is what I use. This one, well, I'll leave it to you to watch. So we come in as I've just put the tool onto the cotter pin and I'm just realizing it isn't popping out.
Really tough one. Double check that I'm pushing correctly. Yes, I am. It's just a very tough one. Maybe it's been in here since the 80s. Wow, a little bit more penetrating oil. Already had some. Now I'm going to start holding the crank at a safe angle so that when the pin comes out, it's definitely going to go downwards. Yeah. Right. The forces that are on here now must be tremendous. I'm kind of waiting for the penetrating oil to dribble down a little bit more into there as well. Now I've got the crank like this. The pin's going to come downwards and it's not going to go through the window or into my face. In fact, if it went into my face, it probably goes through my brain. The force that's on there now. I'm not sure, but I think the tool has got a bit of a bend on it there. I'm thinking the tool might be about to break, which is incredible. So that pin is only held in on the taper, and this tool is a serious piece of steel. But then that top part is a casting, so who knows? This is milled, this is cast by the look of what I'm seeing here. Everything's going, of course, through this pin at the moment and through the threads here. Incredibly, there's no movement on the pin. Some more penetrating fluid, and I'm going to leave that a while. I'm backing it off. I'm going to have a look at the state of things. I've really never known this, and I have kept checking that I'm not pushing on something I shouldn't be pushing on. I'm only pushing on the pin. Right, I've put some serious load back on there now. Give it a couple more pulls. And then I think I'm going to leave it overnight with the penetrating oil soaking in. Hopefully I'll come back in the morning and find things on the floor, it having popped out in the night. That'll be nice. And in case anyone's wondering, yes, I have double and triple and quadruple checked that I'm pushing it the right way. This is pushing on the threaded end, pushing the wedge out. This is the forked end, and I can feel the blunt end, if you like, of the cotter pin poking out there. It needs to fire out this way, downwards, and fire out it will. I'm going to go through to New Zealand at this rate. Oh, might follow it, that'll be nice. I've got a frame number there as well. C 8 8 7 7 5 no 3 7. Yeah, C 0 8 7 7 3 7. Not that the frame numbers make much sense at this date. One last pull, and I'll leave it overnight with that enormous amount of stress on it. Well, it's the next morning, and I've come out here disappointed when I walked up and found the tool still on here, and an end of a cotter pin sticking through underneath here. However, when I touched it, I realised the cotter pin is sticking out more. And then look, the tool is flat down on the top. The cotter pin has popped in the night, but not gone flying out, it's just popped enough. So success, I will just knock that cotter pin out there now, and I can get on, take the bottom bracket out in order to do something about these seized screws here by getting this bracket off. So this bracket is held on by the bottom bracket. It's holding the chain guard on, which is holding the cranks on. So everything is held on the bottom bracket. Not a design that I'm very keen on, but it's what Raleigh came up with after years of having the hockey stick chain guards fastened by a bracket onto here, which was perfectly
perfectly serviceable for decades. They went over to this continental style wraparound, which I suppose they could tout as an improvement, but it wasn't. So if this hadn't come out, what was next? Next was to apply some heat. I don't have an oxyacetylene torch. I really should have an acetylene blowtorch at least, and I could have applied some heat. What I was going to do was just strip the remains of the frame off and then carry it into the kitchen, put it over the gas hob until everything reached cherry red, and then give it a good whack or apply the tool again. After that, it would have been laying the frame into the vise with a socket, not this socket, but a socket covering the end of the pin that would be coming out, and then just squeeze it out in the vise, probably overloading the vise by using pipes on the handle. It is a method that people have recommended in the ongoing Facebook debate about cotter pins. I don't approve of it myself because it ruins vices, but it would have been my next port of call. And then the final one would have been an angle grinder through the crank arm at the point of the pin. So you slice it open, where the pin goes through, then you whack it here, which bends the arm and opens the slice up, and then the pin can just drop out. That's the last resort, but they always will come off in the end, even if you have to destroy them. They never don't come off. Sometimes I've thrown frames away when it's just been marginal whether or not it was worth it anyway, but if you're trying to save a potentially good bike, it's worth it. So there we are. I'll get on and take this off now. I'll have to check against photos of when I first got this to see whether I have actually bent it. I don't know, it's looking to me as though it's got a bend in it, which is quite some achievement. The pin's okay though. Now, I don't like tapping them, but then in this case it's not going to be reused. The reason for not tapping them is so you can't reuse them afterwards. It ruins the threads. Doesn't matter on this one because it's not going to be reused. So I'm using a punch. I would rather usually use a drift, just a straight piece of rod. I haven't got one to hand and I just want to get on and do this, so I'm just using a punch on the end. And it's still got some grip, although it's moved. It's still got some grip. This is getting interesting. Now, this is the tool. I've just made a slight modification. Scroll back a minute or two, you'll see that this used to be more curved than it is now. I've just taken a little bit off. I did modify this originally. Look back to my earlier videos to see how I drilled this little dimple in here. There, I drilled that in to give the cotter pin something to engage in. What I've found now, I just wanted to give this an extra push through. The curve at the end of the jaw here was actually fouling on the crank and not allowing me to push the pin through to the fullest amount. So I've just flattened that off, and now I can get a little bit more push on the pin. Push it that a little bit further down the taper just to break the hold a little bit more. I will now fiddle and faff to get it back on again, because I had to back the pin right off. There are tools specifically made for this job available. It used to be available from Park, but not anymore, and Bikesmith in America. Very, very good tools. They actually use the pin, this part, to bear down on the cotter. So there's a bit less faff. It's just like a big U shape, and it's got the pin going through, almost like a big G clamp. less faff in the adjustment. I would like one of those, but they're expensive and hard to get. Now I'm showing you now where the tool is on the end of the cotter. You might be able to see how it's clear of everything. Can you imagine when that jaw here was longer and came down more, it just wouldn't give the full amount of push on the pin. That should push it much further now. I'm trying to keep my hand on it as well so I can feel if it's bending at all. It's still, although it's moved, it's still gripping very hard. Putting my head down now to look against the back light to make sure that I'm not just pushing against the crank. More penetrating fluid, which is 50% automatic transmission fluid, 50% acetone, tried and tested by various restorers and car people and such like against the brand leaders in penetrating fluids, and this always comes out on top. I had some of each laid around, so I'll mix some up. So another little modification to the tool now. I've taken a little bit more off the back of here. That was beginning to touch the crank as well. I still recommend this tool overall, but now that it's up against its limitations, it's giving me the opportunity to do a couple of more tweaks to it to make it more specific to cotter pin removal, especially under extreme cases like this one. Remarkable how it's still putting up so much resistance after having moved overnight. Doing another check, make sure everything's clear. Yes, there's clearance all around. I'm not bearing on anything but the head of the cotter pin. And now I'm going to have to use a spacer on the tool because I've reached the end of the threaded portion. And look at the bend in that. That's definitely got a proper bend on it. And see, I've reached the end of the threaded portion now. And I am just pushing down on the pin and nothing else, as you can see there. So with another squirt of fluid, I'm going to leave that with a lot of force on it again and see if it cracks anymore. A few hours later, that's moved, and look, the tool's loose. Yeah, that head is now down flush. That has moved.
Obviously not meant to use a drift on this job because I definitely can't find it. Another go at the punch. Still in there hard. It's moved all that way out now and it's still in hard. Gonna be time for some heat in a minute. Time for some heat. Here's another thing you can use a ball joint splitter for. Slip the fork down behind the crank. It nicely goes over the axle. And then you can give it a whack to push the crank outwards. Very useful on square taper cranks that are stuck on the taper. There is another kind of ball joint splitter which is just a fork tool. And that is superb for that job. What I'm doing now is just trying to move the crank in all directions, just trying to move it round on the pin to break that taper, give it some shocks. As you can see, I've taken the little zip tie off so that I can move the crank around better. Right, it's had another soak. I've modified the punch into a drift. I'm all wet now because I had to quench that in a bucket of water outside. Right, here we go. Well, wasn't that dramatic? One innocent little bit of metal. Let me go retrieve it from the bin, it's just fallen in. Here we are, this is it. You see there's a ridge on there, so that is definitely a worn cotter pin, so it is useless anyway. But that's it, it's the taper. It's being reluctant to let go of the taper that has caused all that. Amazing. And so, when you think about it, not so much nowadays, but until not that long ago, cars and lorries, they were driven by what's called an axle key. It's a little key in the axle, which is basically a little piece of metal sitting in a slot in the axle and a slot in the hub. Maybe quarter of an inch either dimension, 6-7 millimeters square, and that would drive the vehicle. Now we've got this one playing silly buggers now. Crank doesn't want to come off now. But I've got the pin out. I can faff on with this at my leisure. So there was the saga of the stubborn cotter pin. Didn't need any heat in the end. Would have had heat had it failed completely. But the tool got it as far as the head being flush. So it got it off the taper. All it was being held on really, I think, was the towards the end was the pin in the hole. I couldn't have done it without that tool unless I'd just put a slice through there with the angle grinder and cut the thing off. And I've been able to do a couple of modifications to the tool now, so it's now much flatter along the bottom surface, so it sits further onto the pin. I'm going to drill this little dimple deeper now as well, for the head to sit in. Not that it slipped off, but I'm just not too confident about it. Now I've ground away the other material. So if you have
got the ball joint splitter and I've used the ball joint splitter method. There's a little modification for you, particularly for those cotter pins that don't come out with a crack but still grip all the way to nearly flush. That's what caused it. It was the fact that it didn't just come out with a crack like the other side, that it gripped all the way to being flush and beyond. I mean, it was below flush when I just came back to it now and gave it a whack. And that, I have to say, was also due to the penetrating compound. 50% acetone nail polish remover and 50% automatic transmission fluid. I have both within reach, I think, to show you. I'm about to make some more up because I've nearly used it all. Automatic transmission fluid for a car, any brand will do, and nail polish remover. Those two, 50-50. Let me show you better. There we are, 50-50 those two. So they have to share the credit, I think, for that little victory. So as I say, I hope that's been useful. I'm going to get on with the refurb of this now. You'll see that in due course, transforming this old knackered Caprice into a smart Dutch style bike and giving it a new lease of life. I've done it before on other bikes. You've seen the Chilton that I did. This will be something like that. So stay tuned, subscribe if you haven't already, and thanks for watching. And I'll just leave you with the words of the great Norman Stanley Fletcher. Little victories, Gobber. That's what it's about. Little victories.